Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining the IMAA's Insights and Innovation Series for this Monday. Today, we have some very, very special guests and good friends of the IMAA. First and foremost, we've got the touch of celebrity with Dave Hughes. He's going to be talking to us, so we're appreciative of that. We're also talking with Nikki, Rourke, Luke, Joe and Amanda, who are going to walk us through certain parts of what's happening at the moment in the industry. But without further ado, I'll hand over to Nikki Rourke, who is a good friend of the Indies, and to tee things off and introduce everyone. Over to you.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Sam. And thanks, everybody, for having us today. Really appreciate the turnout. And yes, it's a great pleasure to have Hughesy on the call, and we're going to kick over to Hughesy and Amanda in a second for a bit of Q&A and a bit of insight into what Hughesy's been doing during lockdown and how he's managing it all, plus a few other topics. And then we've got Joe and Luke on the call, and Joe's going to talk a bit about the IMAA partnership. And Luke's going to take us through some audio best practice and some really brilliant learnings that we've got lately, and some of the work that we're doing to really optimize results using best practice creative. And I know the forum today is all about innovation, and it would be very easy to talk about distribution on platforms and digital audio, but we did that last time, and we thought better use of our time today would be to talk about two of the great hallmarks of audio success. One of them is having some of the best talent in the business with a hugely loyal following who engages with our audience every single day, making content every single day and driving some brilliant results for advertisers. And then the work that Luke and his team do in studio, which is ensuring that we're putting the best possible product to air. And probably one of the most underutilized opportunities we think in audio, which is to get the creative proposition really right and firing and right for all platforms. So that's where we decided to focus our energies today. So thanks so much for having us. And I will apologize in advance. I may have to leave the call slightly early, but I'm going to hand you over into the very capable hands of Amanda Unwin, who's our head of sales in Sydney. And she's going to kick off with a Q&A with Hughesy. So over to you, Mans.
Thank you, Nikki. I get the fun part today. And a very big thank you to you, Hughesy. This is actually your week off from radio.
It is.
And you're a very busy man. So you do breakfast radio. You get to do that on Today FM with Ed Cavalier and Erin Molan. Also doing The Masked Singer at the moment. Great outfit last night. We loved it. And you are in lockdown with your family, and you're having to do things like homeschooling, which a lot of the people on the call will also have to be doing themselves. So first question, how on earth are you managing all of this?
Look, I mean, I think I'm looking pretty good today, but I mean, I'm not a prop comic, but sometimes with lockdown, it's pretty much how I look like most of the time. So it's like, I mean, I think we're all in this, certainly in anyone who's in Sydney or Melbourne, you know, who's had enduring long lockdowns, we all have to reach deep within ourselves to keep a happy place. So I am doing that, but I'm daily epiphanies for me. So my epiphany today, Amanda, is stay off social media, to be honest. I've been arguing on Twitter for way too much. And but if I only go on social media today to post positive things or look after sponsors, but not to get any arguments. So
I love that. We'll talk about your Twitter account. But are the kids love having you there home all the time?
Oh, they do. I just played basketball in the backyard with my two daughters and my son. So look, that is absolutely an advantage of this situation, that you can, I'm spending much more time with the children, and they love having you around, if only for someone to mock. And my children mock me so mercilessly. It's like, sometimes I have to say to them, my subconscious doesn't know that you're joking, all right? So I honestly can't take my shirt off at home. Like, I'm a 50-year-old man who has to have my shirt on because my torso disgusts my children, apparently. So this is a true story. Yeah. Recently, my 8-year-old daughter said, Dad, you've got boobs. And I said, well, you haven't, so who's the winner? So,
But are they impressed by the success that you've had on both radio and television? Surely they love having a high profile dad.
Well, you know what, if they are, they're doing a really good job at hiding it. So I mean, I want to produce humble children, but I might have gone too far down in that, because they really they are unassuming, and they just don't care about it, to be honest. So, which is good in a way, so I can get them on the radio and they just they'll just speak naturally without, you know, worrying. So I've got them on TV a lot. I'm happy to do a reality show with them, to be honest. They'd be up for it, but my wife is slightly reluctant. But yeah, no, the kids are very, very nonchalant about their dad's fame, and they're forever stirring me, you know. The true story, my daughter once said to me, Dad, I'm a bigger deal than you are. And I said, how's that so? She said, I don't have haters.
Well, you know you've made it if you've got some haters.
Exactly. I said, Sadie, they hate me because they know me. If they knew you, they'd hate you too, right?
Oh, well, you mentioned your wife there, and I know yes. You guys have been together a really long time. Does she still find you funny?
Look, she does, yes, I believe. I mean, again, she may hide it as well. No, look, we've been together 20 years, so, I mean, that's a fair, you know, in showbiz, that's a big effort, you know what I mean? So I remember when we first started going out, true story, back in, 2000 and early 2002. So we've been together nearly 20 years. And I think our first red carpet appearance was at a Spider-Man premiere, and Darren Hinch, the famous broadcaster, said on his radio show, because a photo ended up in the paper, he said on his radio show, a comedian and a journalist, that won't last. Well, we've outlasted about five of Darren's livers, basically, so we're still going. So, yeah, no, yeah. We still get along really well, which is great.
Yeah, 20 years. Congratulations. That is a long time. But a lot of people do say that you're batting out of your league with her.
Yeah,
that comes up on social. So how do you cope with that?
They've been saying that for 20 years, there's no doubt. But when we first started going out, I was 31 and she was 22. And at that time, people would say to me, why don't you go out with a girl your own age? And I would say, well, they had their chance 10 years ago. So they didn't want Hughesy on the dial. They're not getting Hughesy on the radio. people do say, they just cannot compute the fact that we're together. I remember Mark Holden, the Australian Idol judge, once said, he came in the radio show and said, it's Beauty and the Beast. I mean, come on, Mark. But I tell you, when my own children started, Amanda, that's what annoys me. When, you know, I remember a few years ago, my son said, Dad, did you meet Mum after you got famous? I'm like, why do you ask, mate? He said, no reason. And he lulled me into a false sense of security. I said, well, you know what? I was on radio when we met. So, yes, I did. And he was about seven at the time. He goes, that makes sense, Dad. Does it, mate? Couldn't do up his own shoelaces at that moment, but he could work out how his father's relationship had worked out. I said, look at my face. He said, why? I said, because you've got this face. You want to get funny real quick, mate. I can tell you.
Some wise words.
He's got a girlfriend at the age of 12, to be honest, which is...
Oh.
Yes, and she's the school captain. He's like, you know, just, I don't know. It annoys me that he doesn't understand that, you know, a man can wait a long time to get a girlfriend.
Oh, well, he's stuck 12. That's a good effort by him. And we speak about the family impact of you being in the public eye. And this has obviously played out for you when you can be out and about. Do you enjoy being recognised?
I do. I'm not going to lie. I mean, wearing a mask in public has been probably the toughest thing about lockdown for me, to be honest. I just, you know, when you're lining up for a coffee and they say your name is, it just breaks my heart, you know. It's like, but sometimes I say it anyway because they're Irish backpackers, which really annoys me. I really do think there should be some sort of test at the airport. We don't know who Hughesy is, you can't come in. So, look, I do love getting recognised. I've been getting papped recently, though, which is, I don't love. So I got papped recently. I was playing basketball with my kids and I wasn't wearing a mask, and that ended up on the Daily Mail. I actually sent a message. They asked for a comment because they said I'd got in a fight. And I hadn't gotten in a fight. So it was ridiculous. I was playing basketball. But I said to my manager, I was probably running. I didn't know where the photo was from because I thought I must have been running. So, and then they printed that printed my comments, claims he was jogging, and I was in jeans and a shirt, and I was it was like, come on, Daily Mail. Yeah. Give me a break. Anyway.
Oh, there must be some crazy headlines when they catch you doing these random things.
There's been a lot of headlines over the years, I can tell you. But I'm someone who welcomes the headlines generally. I I've never gotten any proper trouble, and so I'm happy to generate a few headlines. So.
Yeah. And look, speaking of you being recognised, it is that voice that is very distinctive. And we talk a lot about that with our agencies, the importance of being distinctive, whether you're a brand or profiled talent. What is your favourite thing about working in audio?
Oh, I absolutely love radio, and I, you know, I love how it's extending through to the podcast world as well now. So that digitally, there's so many ways to access what you do. So I've always loved the theatre of radio, and I love the connection you can have with people on a daily basis. So, you know, and people really, once they get on to you, they can stick fat for years. So yeah, it's the intimacy of it, I believe, that I really do love. So yeah, I've always been in love with radio and always will. I mean, I remember my first radio job was on a community radio station back in my hometown, where, you know, we got sacked after our first shift, to be honest. So we talked about the size of a whale's penis, and that it breached community radio standards.
Oh, gosh. Well, you are now on Today FM Breakfast with the Morning Crew. You're there with Ed and Erin. Tell us a little bit about that show, because it only started this year.
Yeah, look, I've worked with Ed over the years a lot in different forums, and we have a great relationship where, you know, he's a guy who I'll just ring at any point and just for a laugh. So we get the same, we laugh at the same stuff, which is great. So, and we did drive for once Kate Langbrook left, we did drive, she went to Italy and I followed Italy, and then she wouldn't come back. So I ended up doing Drive with Ed, and it was, you know, it went really well. We're rating really well. So, you know, when the opportunity to do Breakfast came along, we jumped at it. And, you know, and then Erin came along as well, who's an absolute character, Erin Molan. She's wears her heart on her sleeve. She's so Sydney, and, you know, we love her. And she's just recently single too, so that's opened up a whole new avenue, which we will slowly explore. But she's someone who's prepared to laugh at herself. So, yeah, so we're having a hell of a lot of fun in the mornings, I must say.
Yeah, you can tell. You can tell listening in, and it's a real joy to hear the three of you and your banter. We do have on the call a lot of our independent agency partners. So a question for them, if they're to think about using you for brands and clients that they're working with, how do they best work with you, and what are your passion points for the commercial partners?
No, you know what? I'm going to be brutally honest here. I once worked in sales back in the day at a community or a newspaper, basically, and I know how tough it can be on a daily basis. I lied at the time and said I had a car, and I didn't have a car at all. So I had to rely on public transport to try and help out and try to get clients. I'd have a lot of weeks where nothing really went on, to be honest. But look, what you'll get from us, and anyone who's experienced, you know, getting a company, a brand on board with us, is you'll get full commitment. And you know, where we respect the business, and we respect, you know, the what we're all trying to do. So, you know, any company that, you know, we had McDonald's recently, and we just we go above and beyond the call of duty. And we'll also use all our, you know, I've got, you know, and me, Erin, and Ed, all have all got huge online presences as well. So, and you across all the platforms, you'll get extra, the brands will get so much extra love. And, you know, we commit fully when a brand's involved, and I guarantee you'll be just blown away by the passion we show for whatever brand is brought to us, basically. And we really do look to give full value. So I just think anyone who can get a brand across the line with us, they will not regret it, and the brand will come back to them and go, wow, we can't believe how committed those three were to what we're doing. So yeah, I absolutely 100% hand on heart know that's the case. So yeah, big time.
Yeah, love that confidence. And certainly we are getting such great results from clients that are jumping on board. So I love that. Is there certain categories or products that you're personally really passionate about that we could explore for you?
Not really. I honestly, I'm prepared to commit to anything, honestly. I really am. I just don't put anything don't write anything off. So
okay.
I swear to God, honestly wouldn't want to narrow it down. And the three of us will, you know, we'll absolutely, even if we weren't committed, you know, we will find the commitment. And you will not, no one will regret coming on board with us in the amount of passion that we'll show the product.
Yeah, love that. So just before we let you go, we've now seen both Gladys's and Dan's roadmap out of the lockdowns. I'm very keen to hear, is everyone starting to plan for what out the other side looks like? What are you most looking forward to?
Oh, look, it's hashtag summer of love for me. You know, it's we're looking for a summer where we can just do normal stuff. But personally, stand-up comedy is such a passion of mine and has been, you know, for almost 30 years now, that I just cannot wait to get back on stage and which, you know, and connect with people in that live sense. So I'm just looking forward to, you know, spitting on the front row, to be honest. it's you're in the front row, so it happens. So yeah, I really am looking forward to just saying to the family, got to go, got stand-up comedy to do. So
have a tour.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, as am I, and I'm sure a lot of people on this call can't wait for some live comedy. But this morning, or this afternoon there in New South Wales, thank you so much for joining us and providing a little bit of comic relief, but also just sharing how our commercial partners can work with you. It's been a real pleasure, Hughesy.
Now, I respect what you all do, and you are the true soldiers of the business, seriously, and we couldn't happen without you. And anyway, our radio show can get involved, or me personally, don't hesitate to reach out. So yeah, 100%. Thank you, guys.
There you go. All right, Hughesy, we'll let you go. Thanks again.
Thank you. Have a good day. See you guys.
So there you have it, Hughesy. And I think the commitment there was he will blow away any of our commercial partners that come on board. So I've written that one down. We're now going to shift gears a little bit. And Nikki mentioned that Luke Parsons is going to talk to us about innovation in the audio space. So Luke's got his slide up there. Luke, give us a wave just so people can pin you
Hello.
On their screen. Over to you, our head of studio in Sydney, Luke Parsons.
Thank you, Mads. Appreciate that. There's a few chuckles there. Spitting on the front row, I've jotted down, but he's absolutely a legend. And hopefully today what I'll talk about is more about the creative side of effectiveness and kind of pull back the creative curtain and show you what we're doing in the new age of creative. And that is, if this moves. Look at this. Is that moving for you guys?
Yep, it's moved, Luke.
Brilliant. Thank you. So hopefully by the end of this presentation, what I'm going to give you is a different perspective of audio and showcase the new era in creative and how we're really driving results in a meaningful level for you guys and obviously your clients. Now, the one thing that audio does, it moves people and it moves it for brand reasons or it can be tactical reasons. And what I'm going to do is press play on one of these moments, and it's meant to be an emotive moment. But what I want you to do is really engage with it and kind of break it down, associate those emotions with an element of that audio. And then I'm going to talk about what makes that effective. And then we'll talk about the innovations coming through. So yell out Nikki or Amanda or Joe if you cannot hear this.
Imagine growing up Indigenous in Australia, stepping onto the world stage in your own backyard, in front of millions around the world, and achieving greatness.
Away, Freeman out well, a mighty roar surrounds the stadium. Hogan Poyer wide sailing, Freeman, they're holding their stagger early. Graham's gone out strongly in the back straight, she's in the middle. So down the back, Kathy, three from the left. Graham's gone out really hard to Guevara. Freeman going strongly, up to almost halfway. She's three from the top. You can see Graham inside of her, probably in front. Mary's having a good run. This is where Kathy exploded in Atlanta. Graham's in front of her. Freeman's got work to do here. There's about 150 to go. Guevara and Mary are right up. It's going to be a big finish. Into the straight, Graham leads. Freeman runs up to her. Mary inside. Kathy lifting. Goes up to Graham. Takes the lead. Looks the winner. Draws away from Graham and Mary. This is a famous victory. A magnificent performance. What a legend. What a champion.
Now, a pretty special moment, right, in our history. And what you could have associated those emotions with. It could have been at the start, the priming, where we start that story narrative. It could be the cadence in the voice, and that's what we call directing the voice. And if we went over to the music, what that would be is rhythm and melody that makes you feel something. Or if I chose the speech, what it would be is obviously the strength of the words and how you cast the voice. And it's all of these elements coming together that's the new era of creative, and using data platforms to make sure we're optimizing all of these elements to drive better results for you guys and your clients. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to cover off three things. I'm going to talk about the evolution of audio. And that's important to know because our brains are wired in a certain way, and what we're understanding this, and we're really maximizing effectiveness by understanding it. We're going to talk about a really quick overview of the current landscape, where the audio situation is. Then I'm going to talk about innovations that in SEA are really driving in the market. So let's go back when we were cavemen, right? Audio is really, really primal. It's always on. You got to think of audio like the bodyguard of your senses. It's on 24/7 looking to protect us, and it always has. So it could be when we're in the savannah, you might be able to see the lion, but you heard that paw break the stick. And what that did is instantly we either flee, like we ran away, or we fought that lion. We did that, that'd be pretty silly, right? And the other thing it does, it triggers emotions. And another example of that, if you walk into a forest and you hear the birds chirping, it makes your body relax. And that's because we've grown up and our brains are wired in. When birds are singing, it's safe. So there's a lot of triggers that we're uncovering that we're using to create action, and we're using to evoke strong emotion. The other thing about audio, it's the first sense to develop in the womb, and that is absolutely by default, because what that does is grow an intimate relationship between baby and mother. And what you hear is actually a really warm bass noise, and that's why people that are lucky enough to have a timbre voice are more attractive, or that's why we use in our music a lot of bass notes to make people excited or feel safe. The other thing audio has done for a very long time is pass down beliefs and traditions through story narrative. And what this has given us is utility, and it's prevented us from either eating a berry. So we've used stories to say that berry's good or that water hole is safe. And what that has done is wired our brain to remember things via audio. And it's really important to remember, because we've still got these brains wired in that way. And we're now uncovering them and using them from a creative perspective to drive complete effectiveness. The other thing is you hear before you see, and that's important because you might be able, it's too late if you see that line. You had to hear that line before it. But what that means in this day and age is it drives the communication perception. It's that light on stage. So those first few seconds of priming are really, really important from an audio perspective, but also from a video perspective. And audio is unforgettable. I've already touched on some of those things, but what makes audio unforgettable is it makes you paint your own picture. And this is the strength of audio, of actually not having visuals, because it makes your brain work just that little bit more, which makes better memory structures, which gives salience. So your brands are recalled in the right buying moments. And a melody can seep in and last an absolute lifetime. And that's why at the age of three, we all learn 26 letters. And that's the ABC. That's the power of the melody. And I'm going to show you, and you might have to turn your speakers up for this video, but I'm going to show you how unforgettable melody and rhythm truly is.
Hi, Papa.
Huh?
How you doing?
I'm all right. Fine.
Who am I?
I don't know. Wait a minute.
Okay, it's Jerry. Henry.
Yeah?
Henry.
Yes, Joe.
I found your music. You want your music now?
Okay.
Let's try your music, okay? And then you tell me if it's too loud or not.
And he used to always sit on the unit with his head like this. He didn't really talk to much people. And then when I introduced the music to him, this is his reaction ever since.
Did you like music when you were young?
Yes, I went to big dances and things.
What was your favorite music when you were young?
Well, I guess, Cab Calloway was my number one band guy I liked.
What's your favorite Cab Calloway song?
Oh, I'll be home there for Christmas. You can count plans on me with plenty of.
So Henry couldn't remember his daughter, but he could sing his favorite melody and rhythm from his favorite artist. And it just shows that audio can make memory indestructible. So audio is very primal. It's the bodyguard of the senses. It's been trusted for a very long time. And we can wrap that brand message within that trusted forum. It absolutely sets the perception of any communication, whether that's TVC or audio. It's highly emotive. And just think of your favorite film and the favorite scene within that. Guaranteed there's a music bed that's lifting that emotion up, because audio informs you in how to feel. And it's highly memorable. And that's rhyme, that's story, and it's also rhythm and melody. And we're exploiting all of these and understanding these from a creative perspective to drive the client objectives and to drive effectiveness. But let's bring it to now. Where are we now? And I'll give you a really quick overview, then we'll go into the innovations and how we're using them. So there's more platforms than ever. It's the renaissance or the golden era of audio, because more people are listening to audio than there ever has been. We're crafting, because of all these beautiful digital tools that we've got, we're crafting in really unique ways. And that's what I'll tap into the innovation. And we're highly accountable. I know you guys would spend a lot of money on digital platforms. Well, we're just as accountable to all of those performance platforms. And for us, we are the total audio solution. So we're going to make it really easy for you guys. And one of the beautiful things is, which I'm sure you know of, is we've invested heavily in Listener, which is our digital platform, which centralizes the news, the music, you know, sports, radio, everything that makes audio great into the one system. So think of us, the one-stop shop, to make it easy for you guys and your clients to drive effectiveness across the whole audio ecosystem. And when I say audio ecosystem, what do I mean? Well, I mean the main pillar, radio. Radio is always going to give you that beautiful reach. And with SEA, you get metro and regional, and you can get it on that community level on scale. We've got beautiful music streaming services. An example of that is SoundCloud. SoundCloud's a youth platform. We have about 3 or 3.5 million streamers per month. And you get all the beautiful addressable audio within that platform. We've got podcasts. We were the first team to really bring to life original podcasts. We've got about 117 of them, which means we can use all of this skill that we've got in human resource to make a branded podcast for big, medium, or small clients. And that can be a brand asset for you guys. And then we've been playing in or dabbling in for about 3.5 years, the voice ecosystem. And an example of that is smart speakers. Let's talk about how we're using innovation. And there absolutely has been a craft explosion. If you rewind about 5 years ago, what we're doing is writing 30-second ads really well. And that was quite a linear format. But now we've got dynamic audio. We can do 1,100 executions for the one client on that. We can do mood audio. So matching mood and their need states to communicate on scale, relevancy on scale. We've got 3D audio, the newest technology and the most immersive way to experience audio, smart speaker interactions, and we've got 41% penetration of our audience that do have a smart speaker in their home. So it's actually got more scale than people realize. We've got addressable audio, and one of the big movers and shakers is distinctive assets. And I'll talk to you how we're doing that. So we've got all of these great innovations, but one of the best things that we've got, and it's exclusive to SEA, is Veritonic. Now, Veritonic informs us creatives on optimizing the audio. It tells us if it's engaging, if it's going to increase recall, and the attributes it's likely to elicit, so we can marry that up with the brand values of your clients. And it's a really important in creating distinctive assets. And we created a product called Brand Sound. It's for big clients, medium clients, and smaller clients. So we've tiered it, made it accessible for all. And what we use is our in-house composers. And we work with the data platform to ensure that we create that musical thumbprint that's distinctly yours, and you can own that in perpetuity. The other thing is we did a really big mood study. And when I say big, it was about 5,325 people. And what we wanted to first understand is, in the different big buying demographics, do their moods change throughout the day? And it so happens they did. And within that mood, does their need of information change? And it does. So the beauty about audio, it's highly efficient, and particularly from a production element. So that means we can create different executions across different day parts to give you relevancy on scale. So I'll give you a really quick example of that. So between the 25 and 54 year olds, they're mainly tired, but they're a little bit happy when they wake up between 6 and 9. What they want is to be updated, what is going on in the world, but they need it in an uplifting way. And that's why breakfast radio works so well, because it's entertaining but informative. So what we do, we translate that as creative writers, and we inform with friendly energy. And we use Veritonic to make sure we're on point for that particular client. We then go to a different day part, and they're more focused. So this is the lean out. And this is, I suppose, the platform that I'm really interested in, because for you guys, it's cost efficient. But from a creative perspective, we can really create a lot of salience, because we can increase frequency, but we can use the power of rhythm and melody. And I'll give you a tangible taste of that. So we've extrapolated all of this information, and we've used it to curate more relevant messages for you and your clients. So this is Woolworths. I'll give you an example of how we would write for this particular day part, and then I'll show you the following day part. Now, just listen to the priming and the voice. And this is just a price and product 30-second ad.
Avocados have never been so perfect for picking. The best ripe avo has just a little give in the flesh, while the greener ones usually come good in a day or two. Grab one for now and one for later with two avocados for $4 from Woolies.
And then the next one, what you're going to hear is it works within that family, but it uses the rhythm and melody from that distinctive asset. And it would sound something like this.
We're Woolworths, the fresh food people, with fresh ideas for you. Woolworths, the fresh food people.
So we're using different communication to match different moods and different need states. The other thing that we've been playing around with for a very long time, we're the first in Australia to partner up with Sennheiser, and it's 3D audio, or an element of that is ASMR. And what I'll do is I'll send this 3D audio around, because if I play it, it compresses over VC, but I need you to really feel it's the 360 of audio. It gives you depth and feel, and it's a real novel way of clients to interact with their consumers. It became famous because of the gaming console. So they had the visuals, but they didn't quite have the audio worked out. So they used this technology. We grabbed that technology and now we use it. And we've had to upskill quite considerably because it's more of a theatrical. You write very differently, as in you've got noise coming from the left and then it goes down. So you've got to direct and write quite differently. So we spent 9 months with Sennheiser to do doing R&D to make sure we could commercialize this with meaning for your clients. The other thing we've been playing around with is smart speaker, and SEA is lucky because the hardest thing about creating a voice app is discovering it. But we have media on smart speakers that helps that discovery element. And we did something, we proposed to do something once that bubble ever opens up with New Zealand. And it was called Kiwi Translator. And the idea is New Zealanders use different lingo than we do. So it was a tool that Aussies could use so they could translate things like when we say esky, what's that mean in New Zealand? Well, it's chili bin. So before we went over there, we kind of had our own, the local vocab, so we could travel Kiwi in all of its abundance. And this is all about creating fame. And you can imagine the talent using this and interacting with this and amplifying it through all of our ecosystem. Now, the things that you're probably really interested in is dynamic audio, which is hyper-relevancy. This is where we can do 1,100 executions. And we did this for 7-Eleven, and we did it in the filtering from city, so it was Melbourne, and weather. And what we did is we married up the weather with the certain product offerings that 7-Eleven had, and it sounded something like this.
Damn, it's hot right now. And because Melbourne air conditioning isn't built for 40 degree days, the only way to cool down is with a 7-Eleven Slurpee from just $1. So it's just started raining, and you didn't bring an umbrella to work because it was sunny when you left home. Typical Melbourne. Doesn't matter though, grab an umbrella from your nearest 7-Eleven. Wow, it's cold right now. Not as cold as Melbourne's coldest summer day on record, 5.5 degrees, but still cold enough to need a 7-Eleven pie or sausage roll to help you warm up. You're in the CBD right now, so you're in luck. There are over 15 7-Eleven stores really close by. You're near St Kilda right now, so you're in luck. There are 5 7-Eleven stores close by. 7-Eleven, good call.
So that's hyper-relevancy. One of the last innovation is shakeable tech. And this is really exciting because a lot of audio or digital audio consumption is over the phone or using the phone. And now what we can do is have an interactive ad where you can shake your phone and you can add on to the conversation. It could be just simple as a promo code where we drive people in store, or it could be engaging them in an entertaining way using, as an example, Hughesy to bring to life another communication message. And the last innovation is how we're far more accountable as an ecosystem. And some of the ways I've already discussed, which is Veritonic, we're the only ones that are creatively accountable because we've got Veritonic and it's exclusively ours. So we can optimize your audio, whether it's for big, midterm or smaller clients. We've got footsteps, so we can measure campaigns if it is driving footfall into your client's store. We've got brand lift studies. So as we kind of discuss, audio is also great for building brand in an efficient and effective way. And we've got some great research team, and we can measure 12 different metrics to ensure that we uplift any of your brand metrics. We've got impact. Impact is also across broadcast and digital now, and it's an attribution tool. Did that campaign drive web hits? Well, we can answer that definitively now. And then the latest is Spend IQ. So it's transactional data. And this enables us to answer, did that campaign increase transaction for your clients? So this is the many ways in which we're using audio to not only be accountable, but to really drive effectiveness. I'll pass it over to you, Joe, to talk about what we're doing for this consortium.
Thank you very much, Luke. Great presentation, man. Okay, everyone. So we're actually a little bit ahead of time. This is our final slide for today, but we thought it was important to touch on a few of the initiatives and also the perks that we have in place for IMAA and, of course, you as its members. So firstly, as you can see there on the slides, we actually launched a national campaign that started on air with us last week, and it's running across our entire Metro and DAB networks. So as you can see, it will run across the next 6 weeks. And by the end, we will have put to air over 5,000 commercials, which equates to roughly $250,000 worth of airtime. So fingers crossed we're generating a good result for you guys and a great amount of leads for you to get stuck into with some new business. So much like you actually mentioned in the creative for that campaign, we understand, of course, that getting a result for clients is absolutely critical in everything that we do. With that in mind, I just wanted to reiterate how much focus we actually place on measurement and attribution. So Luke, of course, just touched on those different tools at our disposal. But what we're finding is that we're getting a lot of traction with clients, especially with impact, footsteps and brand sound, as it gives them that extra layer of reporting that they're used to seeing from their digital campaigns. We're also very excited about Radio 360 and the upcoming hybrid audience measurement that's actually due to launch at the end of this year. I'm sure a few people on the call have had that awkward conversation explaining to a client the paper diary methodology and seeing them raise an eyebrow. So again, we're very, very excited that we'll have a more robust way to measure audience and also to actually be able to split out our digital listening in a more meaningful way. And lastly, again, we wanted to ensure that you walked away from today with something tangible. So we'd like to offer a few perks to you as IMAA members. So as you can see there on the slides, we'd like to give you access to Impact free of charge. We'd also like to offer you a campaign effectiveness study on any piece of business that you book with us at 100% share. Lastly, we're also aware that creative costs can add up for clients, particularly with dynamic audio that Luke just took us through. So we'd like to offer you free of charge creative and production for all new digital campaigns that you place with us. If you'd like to take us up on any of those offers, just reach out to your account manager as they've got more of those details. But guys, I think that that pretty much wraps us up today, unless there's any last sort of comments or questions, or if you wanted any of those things further elaborated on.